next paper will be presented by Professor Foti and the title is Numerical Analysis of the Time Periodic Dynamic Behavior of Cable-like System Under Steady Wind. So please.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to thank also the organizing committee and of course to acknowledge my co-authors, Professor Perotti and Martinelli, both from Politecnico di Milano. This presentation deals with the development of a numerical procedure to study the dynamic response of cables interacting with a fluid flow, namely a wind flow, fully accounting for geometric nonlinearities, material nonlinearities if needed, and a full nonlinear model for aerodynamic interacting forces developed within the framework of the quasi-steady aerodynamic theory, so explicitly conceived for example, galloping, to study galloping phenomena. Within this context, we are especially interested in to investigate the role of bending and torsional stiffness contributions on the overall response of the suspended cables, more in general cable structures, and to investigate the role of the cross-sectional torsional rotation while evaluating the flat structure interaction forces. To the same, we need the structural theory for beams undergoing large displacements and rotations, and to the same, we adopted a co-rotational framework. The basic idea of co-rotational approaches is, is to decompose the total motion of an element into a rigid body contribution and an approximately pure deformational contribution. This is done by introducing a co-rotated configuration in which the mechanical response of the element is first evaluated and then transformed back to the global reference system of the problem. In the co-rotated, co-rotated framework, we usually adopt the assumption of small displacement strains, which is especially useful for cables, which usually undergoes large deformations, but while retaining small strains. The main advantage in our perspective of co-rotational approaches with respect to other beam formulations, such as, for example, geometrically exact beam models, is that in this way we can deal with the constitutive law, which are developed by considering small, so engineering stress and strain measures, which would result otherwise in non-objective formulations while to study large deformation problems. Practically, we define the co-rotated reference configuration, the co-rotated configuration by introducing a reference system which is attached to each element and rotates and translates with the elements during their motion. The definition of the element is accomplished starting from the knowledge of position and orientation of the nodes of the element. This is described within a Lagrangian updated approach by assuming as global generalized displacements of the formulation, displacement of nodes, and the parameters adopted to represent large rotation, in this case the pseudo-vector of rotation following notations by Arrhenius and the exponential, which is exploited through the exponential map of the rotation group. At the local level, so in the co-rotated frame, we assume a standard Euler-Bernoulli structural theory, so a standard Euler-Bernoulli formulation. In particular, we neglect shear and warping effect, of course, and but we can account for some low-order geometric nonlinearity, such as the bowing. Then, by applying a standard finite element approach, by assuming shape function on displacements and with a suitable cross-sectional sectional law, we can evaluate nodal forces in the corrotated frame, and we can derive a local stiffness matrix. Regarding constitutive laws, definition of constitutive laws for metallic cables is itself an interesting topic, because these elements can be actually regarded as composite elements obtained by assembling helicoidal components. The basic assumption we can do is the linear elastic is a linear elastic constitutive model. Also, in this case, we have to account for some features stemming from the special internal structure of these objects, such as, for example, the sectional coupling between axial and torsional response, which is here represented by a coupling term CT. More in general, however, our formulation can deal with non-holonomic cross-sectional laws, such as, for example, laws which accounts for the steretic effect in bending of metallic wires. This is an example of application of our model in reproducing a quasi-static bending test on steel cables. You can see that the model matched quite well experimental results and showing a typically steretic behavior, but this is another subject. So once we have the response in the local in the local reference system, we can go back into the global one by exploiting the corrotational transformation, which is basically governed by this corrotational transformation matrix, which can be derived in closed form, and it has been done by the research group in previous works. Now, aerodynamic cross-sectional forces are evaluated within the quasi-steady theory. We assume as negligible effects of longitudinal components, so components normal of wind components normal to the cross-section, and we consider two cases basically. The case in which we have, we consider the effect of the torsional rotation, so the rotation of the cross-section with the direction of the impinging wind, and the special case of no cross-sectional rotation. I will omit derivations, however, they are obtained in a quite standard form. We can evaluate the relative flow velocity, the instantaneous angle of attack, and then we came up with aerodynamic forces per unit length in the along wind and crosswind direction, starting from the knowledge of aerodynamic coefficients of drag and lift. Of course, in this case, you can see we neglect the effect of the pitching, or if you want, aerodynamic moment. Then we need something to go from the cross section to the element. In this case, we propose an extension of the finite element formulation proposed by Professors Martinelli and Perotti in a different context, and we define three-node superimposed aerodynamic element. When we say superimposed, we mean that this element is conceived without mechanical characteristics. It is simply superimposed to the finite element discretization of the structure, just to compute, starting from an assumption on the displacements along the elements, the nodal forces due to the interaction with the wind. We can evaluate within this context. Basically, we can evaluate the orientation of a generic section with respect to the wind. Here in the boxes, you see the unit vectors tangent to the normal to the cross section, and then F3 and F2 are in crosswind along wind direction. Then, by exploiting, I will skip details, but then by exploiting the virtual work principle, we can evaluate the generalized forces related to the generalized displacements of the finite element formulation, which are simply the translations of the nodes. The formulation is here applied to a well-known literature case, which has been studied by many researchers, among which Professor Luongo and co-workers. So it's a pleasure to be here to present this work. Here you see the mechanical characteristics of the problem, and especially we adopted cross-sectional properties, which are taken from the analytic works with which we want to have a comparison. Especially, we have a no axial torsional coupling, while the bending stiffness we will say that actually plays not a great role in the problem. We assume that the cross section of the cable is surrounded by an ice deposit. We assume here a standard literature criteria to model the ice accretion. This is a new shapefile taken by our work of Professor Yu and co-workers, and here you see drag and lift coefficients for the section as a function of the angle of attack. Now, going to the numerical model, we consider a regular, a quite regular mesh, which has been defined after some sensitivity analysis. It's a quite coarse mesh, but we want to be able to study such kind of structure with a small number of elements. Just for comparative purposes, we will consider different mechanical finite element, namely the beam element that I presented, the beam element in which we drop the Boeing contribution in the evaluation of the local response, and two elements which react just in just two axial forces, a rotational truss element developed as a special case of the rotational beam one, and a cable element taken from previous works by of the research group. Here you see the nonlinear equations of motion directly written in the spatial discretized form, as usual for finite elements approach. Regarding inertia, we neglect flexural and torsional contributions of cross-sectional inertia because we assume lumped translational masses at nodes, and damping is evaluated by defining according to classic criteria such as those proposed by Clough and Penzin, just by imposing a model damping ratio on the first 40 modes of the structure. Of course, we started by studying the static problem under self-weight only. We compared our results with the classic analytic formulation such as the elastic catenary to study the static configuration. We evaluated also, obviously, the linear modes, and the main result is that all models, all different models, deliver more or less same, I mean, very close results, just why the problem is mainly governed by a membrane behavior, so stiffness, flexural and torsional stiffness play essentially a little role in the mechanical behavior of this problem, at least up to this moment. The next step is to consider the static configuration under the self-weight and the static loss due to the average wind. To this end, we started by comparing different loading procedures to investigate the effect of the definition of the reference sodium deformed configuration of the structure and the loading sequence used to apply the self-weight and the average wind. We distinguish between three procedures. The first one, which is the only starting from a straight reference configuration, while procedure two and three start from a curved configuration, which is evaluated just as the inextensible catenary. Procedures two and three delivers the same results basically. So in this case, the sequence of application of vertical and wind loads is not significant. So in the following, we will compare essentially procedure one with procedure two. Here in this plot, you see the static swing angle, which is the angle at the midspan, which is the angle here in this plot defined by the tangent between the horizontal and vertical position of the centroid of the cross section. This is plot against the wind speed. You can see that results of procedure one and procedure two are quite close, up to 15 meters per second. They tend to be a little different. Just to be, I will go back to that slide. The principal difference between the two configurations is due to the different orientation of the cross sections in the final configuration. I mean, both procedures deliver results which are very similar in terms of displacements. In particular, the cable undergoes a rotation and belongs, except for two boundary layer regions near the clamps, to a planar configuration. But in the first case, the structure reacts essentially to a bending case with respect to a symmetry axis, so there is no significant rotation of the cross-section with respect to the impinging wind. In the other case, you see that we have a rotation psi with respect to the impinging wind, which is zero at the clamps and then varies along the cables. More in details is never equal to the static swing of the structure. This affects mainly the variation of the tension in the cable. Okay, thank you. Here you can see that we have a region in which we have a significant lift effect, which is related to this region of the lift curve, which is not predicted, obviously, by the first procedure. We compared the response with respect to truss and cable models, and we found out that we have exactly the same results if we neglect the torsional rotation of the cross-section in the evaluation of aerodynamic loads. So let me skip some results. We compared the static configuration with an analytical approach by Longo and co-workers, which is obtained essentially under a set of simplifying assumption, and we find a very good agreement between our solutions, which are referred to the case of torsion of neglect. I mean, two cases: the one in which you neglect torsion in the evaluation of aerodynamic loads, and the other one in which you consider it in the evaluation of the loads. Then we studied the dynamics of the system through numerical integrations of the equations of motion, and we. And after the transient, we evaluated the stable state, the steady state oscillation of the system, and we evaluated the vibration amplitude related to the first four modes. Okay, here you see a first comparison of our results. You can see the galloping amplitudes of the system. Interesting enough, here you see a comparison between the beam model in which the torsional rotation is neglected in the evaluation of aerodynamic forces, and the cable model, which neglect torsion both in the mechanical as well as in the aerodynamic part of the formulation. You can see that all models predict the same onset, the same velocity for the onset of galloping vibration, which is close to the one predicted by the Denartog's criterion. All models gives a steady state vibration, which are mainly controlled by the first antisymmetric in plane mode. And interestingly enough, the model in which the torsion is neglected only in the evaluation of the aerodynamic loads match very well with the cable response, so highlighting that stiffness, torsional stiffness and bending stiffness play essentially no role for the mechanical response of the system. But by considering the effect of torsion in evaluation of aerodynamic force, the behavior of the system dramatically changes, both from a qualitative viewpoint, because we have a bounded galloping phenomenon, as well from a quantitative viewpoint. I have to skip some details, but just to go into the conclusions, we compared the results of our numerical simulations with the results of the analytic approach by Luongo and co-workers, and we found a very good agreement between this solution. This encourages us to continue with the developments of this research. In particular, we would like to investigate the influence of the aerodynamic torsional moment on the aerodynamic response of the structure. We want to investigate the effect of more complex constitutive loads, and of course, we want to study more complex structural systems such as multi-span overhead electrical transmission lines, aiming at a better comprehension, of course, of the phenomenon, but also to some engineering applications such as control of vibration of this kind of systems. So maybe I've been a little late, so sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So I will take one or two questions to win time. Yes,
the aerodynamic load, I see in that f of t is independent of the coordinates. How did you get galloping if you did not include the vortices? Include the vortices where the...
No, we basically...
Yeah, aerodynamic load should depend on the states of the system.
Yeah, of course. Let me be clear on this point. So we distinguish basically between vibrations which are induced by vortex shedding phenomena and galloping vibrations in which we have an interaction between the motion of the structure and the and of course the impinging fluid. Here the motion of the structure is accounted for by these two terms here, which are the translational velocity of the cross section and of course this rotation angle here. So basically we
discretize the equation. If you look over that,
yeah,
the wind force is f of t independent of the the aerodynamic load f of t, the one,
yeah,
this is
it, the depends by the configuration of the structure through the vector of Lagrangian coordinate q and its first derivative. And actually, we can consider also, and this is why we work with numerical approaches, because we can consider also variation more complex and more realistic of the aerodynamic loads along the length of the cable, because of course wind speed is not constant in space, and we need both a modulation profile over the height of the structure, as well as we can consider also a spatial distribution of the wind of the wind load. Vortex shedding is a quite different problem, and actually it's not included in this formulation. What you can gain, what you can get by this formulation is a linearized form which is suitable to study buffeting phenomena more than vortex shedding and induced vibration, which is a quite different phenomenon.
So,
A very few questions. Did you experience some numerical problems integrating the complete beam model? Because you have small coefficient, bending stiffness multiplying highest order derivative. Bending stiffness in cable is
yeah,
very
sure.
Low.
No, we didn't work with the continuous equation, so with the continuous system. That's why we compare our results with analytical approaches. What we usually do to check how our discretization in space is good is to make further refinements of the mesh to be sure of the convergence of the solution. In the dynamic response, moreover, higher modes, very high frequencies are damped by the numerical solver, because we adopt an HHT numerical integration scheme just to have a more stable solution.
So thank you once again. Thank you.